So, okay, getting started, guys. I hope everybody is able to hear. And again, very warm welcome, guys, who have just joined in last few seconds. My name is Vishal, and I'm just going to take this webinar, for some objectives. Before I just start with the overall objectives, the agenda which we have for this webinar, let me just introduce myself. You already know my name. I'm having almost, I would say now 12 years plus overall experience, and working in this, now people call it as big data domain. I mean, when we started to call them as just disruptive technologies. And so I'm working in this domain since last 5 years now, 5 years plus, I would say. Just like many of you, if some of you are assuming that some of you are already working in this domain already, my journey started with Hadoop. At that time when there was almost nothing other than the Java docs which were available on Apache website, and over the period of time, moved on to different things, then moved on to Storm, Spark, and now you can say that I specialize more into the implementation of so-called Lambda architecture. Organizations, how exactly you can integrate these systems with their legacy systems. And in terms of the domains, most of my experience comes from the retail domain and banking domain. A bit, some of projects in the telecom and healthcare, but again, they are quite negligible as compared to the others. I think that should be good enough to get started in terms of my introduction. More or less, we can keep getting more about it, or you can even discover about, from the presentation, and then eventually if we meet in the class. Right, guys? So good to go. I hope you're able to see my screen, which talks about agenda. Sure. Great, guys. So, okay, let me just directly come to the agenda part. Just a second. Why exactly this Hadoop reader is jumping? No, I don't want. Okay. So coming to the agenda part here. Few things which we just want to cover, since this is just a session for knowledge sharing, for the awareness of Spark, how exactly it is going to help you in various parts technologically from the career perspective. So let's just talk about some of the points. First of all, why should you even care about learning Spark? Well, this question can be in multifaceted kind of question, because for the guys who are just starting their journey in big data domain, the answer for you for the very same question might be different from the guys who have already invested some time and effort and probably some money all together in the area of Hadoop. So let's just try to explore some part of it, right? That is something which we'll try to address and see if we can get some meaningful answers out of it. Advantages of Spark, yes. So that will basically create the ground, right, for knowing the advantages of Spark over, when I say over Hadoop, probably, because that is something which is kind of benchmark right now. So we'll talk about that and some of the surveys, recent surveys which came out in the recent Spark Summit, which was there in San Jose. So that is something which we'll be talking there. Just a sec. Okay, and then that would be in the part which is like, I'm sure many of you would be looking at it from the career path perspective as well. So we'll be briefly be discovering about that part and how exactly companies are going to use Spark. Well, sounds like a sales pitch? No, not really, because we'll just be discovering about these are the different possibilities. And anyway, I'm not sure how many of you already attended some of our Edureka sessions or not, but there is one USP of Edureka sessions. They never go without hands-on, right? Even if it is the webinars also. This webinar is also not going to be different. At the end of it, I plan to show, after talking about something, you should actually be walking your talk, right? So At the end of it, I plan to do a very small demo, I would say not more than 5 or 8 minutes, wherein I would be running a very simple program on the very same machine, the machine which you are seeing right now, on the very same given. Okay, first I will run it with Hadoop, and then same machine, very same data set with Spark, and then we'll just try to compare what exactly happens there, so that we are comparing apples to apples. And then whatever we have just talked, right, in terms of performance and other part, we should be able to quickly verify it at the end of the session. Looks like a plan to all of you? Does it look like kind of a good use of your 1 hour? Right? Great. Thanks a lot for confirming, Ganesh, others. So let us just get started very quickly. Well, there might, as I heard from some people that, you know, they have attended already some of the courses, big data courses from Ed. So guys, for you, it might be a slight repetition, but then there is a majority of the people who are just, you know, who might be considering Spark as the, you know, their entry point itself in the big data domain. So the question, the big question itself, you know, why should I even care for Spark, right? Well, the answer comes right from the title of this slide, the slide which says Rise of Big Data. There is a nice graph, there are two points, but again, it's not my habit to read the slides, okay? So, again, there are so many people so out that tell me your understanding of big data. Probably it might be a bit time-taking exercise. Let me just share very quickly the version which I have, and then you can confirm whether you agree or disagree on that part or not. So guys, according to me, the meaning of this big data itself, right, is something which is a moving target. When I say moving target, those guys, who some of you who would be already experienced guys, in past, if you were working in RDBMS systems and all, whenever your database admins, you know, your database file size is kind of 10 GB, 20 GB, then dude, you are dealing with a, you know, big data instance altogether, or your database instance is quite huge. I'm sure you must have, right, those people, specifically people who like, you know, administrator plus programmer sort of profile, right? You must have heard about it. Well, this was something which was a scale some 4 years back. Right now, if you talk about it, that scale has tilted. That scale has tilted towards the late part, at least the late parts of GBs. You know, we are talking about some 800, 900 GBs to early terabytes, you know, 5, 10 terabytes, etc. Probably some years down the line, you know, 2 years, 3 years down the line, when people would be talking about it, probably the scale would have shifted further up, you know, late terabytes to early, you know, petabytes and things like that, right? So overall, the point is, it's kind of moving time. So how do you define the big data? I would say the simplest thing is huge volume of the data, and the definition of is changing over a period of time. I hope everybody agrees with this. It's quite simplistic, isn't it? Right? So this is something which I say, only thing which you have to care, the only thing which you have to care is that it's a moving target. Now, this is something I hope everybody understands from the slide. This is what reflects the sentiment that you are having an explosion of data. Well, nothing new. This is what Vishal has just talked about, you know, a few seconds back. But guys, the important thing which is here is the explosion of this data. If you look at it, it is kind of, you know, by this green part, which is unstructured or structured, or if you're lucky, then structured, or otherwise unstructured, semi-structured for data. And who is producing this data, by the way? Let's explore some later. But yes, the idea overall here is that the rise of this big data domain altogether is one of the reasons to go for the systems like Spark. Note, I'm talking about systems like Spark. I'm not really talking about Spark right now, right? I will come to that, right? So far, so good. I hope. Very crisp, very small introduction about big data part. Not sure how many of you have heard about it, or I'm sure, like, if you just do a bit of Googling, you will be finding out this example by yourself also, right? Application of big data, or I would say the sources of big data, right? So this example, which says that if you have like normal Boeing 737 sort of one jet in the sensors, right? They per hour, they are going to produce almost 20 terabytes of data. That's just sensor data. And you have two engines, right? So terabyte into two equals to, you know, almost 40 terabyte per hour. And then if you just kind of you know, consider one single flight, 6 hours flight, which is from New York to LA. That is how much is the overall, you know, how much is the overall data you're talking about, then the number of commercial flights, then the number of days, and this comes to be a mind-boggling number. No prices to guess, it's a huge amount of data. And again, the source itself is mentioned here. The source is Twitter, right? Well, this is something which is right from an established or right from the Google kind of, you know, sources. Am I right? But before I come and even discuss about application and IoT and things like that, guys, do you know from where actually this term itself has originated? The term big data itself has originated. I'm sure if I ask about this question, people start answering about it. More than half of you will be answering Google, as Pradeep has already answered. Some people would be saying Yahoo, LinkedIn, and things like that, right? We will hear more about it whenever we will be talking about, you know, in the actual classes. But right now, just as a precursor, guys, none of these companies, none of these organizations have ever invented this term. This term was first coined in late 1990s in the area called genomics and in the area of astronomy, wherein the satellite images and the data which was being transferred was so huge, or the data which has to be kind of, you know, DNA sequence and other stuff which has to be done, you know, analyzed, was so huge that it was not possible to do it with the conventional systems at all. That was the first time when you heard the term called big data. So no Googles, no Yahoos, no LinkedIns. Okay, I'm using them in plural, by the way. Okay, none of them. Those guys have actually started producing the solutions. Those guys have actually started producing some of the solutions so that you can at least analyze this data. Guys, I hope it is just giving you one extra information pointer, right? So the origin itself is can be from anywhere. Look around, right? From everywhere, if you look around, you have the sources of big data generation. Only thing is, right now, with the advent of the systems or the algorithms like Spark, MapReduce, Storm, and so many other things, you know, NoSQL databases and all, now we are able to process it, right? Earlier, we were not even able to. So, probably, you know, so many examples, let's not waste the time there. But I hope everybody is getting the point, right? That the sources of the big data themselves are almost around. Just look around, you'll find a lot of them. Applications of big data. Well, there is one way again to read the slide. Look. So right now this webinar is having almost more than 100 people present. Okay. All of you are coming from different industries, and I'm sure if you look at this slide, you can probably relate your specific industry to the vertical for which you are doing the project. Am I right or wrong? Right? The other thing, the fact that you are attending this webinar itself, isn't it telling two things? That the adoption of data into different verticals, right? Be it healthcare, be it banking, be it retail, be it telecom, be it transportation management, hotel management, talk about it, right? Find the, you know, application of big data in each and every domain together. I hope that fact should be good enough, right? Or should be practical enough to give you a perspective about it. Isn't it, guys? Right? I'm sure this is more of a common sense thing. Let's move to something which is more interesting. Right, guys? Just a sec. Subhajit, or there are one or two guys who are saying they have lost my audio. I hope others are able to hear, because there are so many people. I just have to check. Okay. Thank you. Thanks for confirming. Thanks for confirming. So those guys who, majority of them are actually saying that they are able to hear. For some of you who, for whom the audio is breaking, there might be a problem at your end wherein, you know, bandwidth issues or something, they may keep coming, right? So requesting you to either please rejoin, that might help. Okay. So now with that, let's move on to the next part. So guys, the moment you talk about big data, right? The moment you talk about data, it is, you keep hearing about Hadoop. Am I right? So much so that you have big data or Hadoop have almost become a synonym, right? Big data, just a second. Again, Rajkumar says he's not able to hear or audio is breaking for him. Rajkumar, probably this is just a problem at your end. Requesting you to please re-log in. That might help. Okay. And others, let me just continue there. Okay. So I was just coming to the point that when you talk about big data, almost it has almost become synonym with Hadoop. All right? You must have these, as those people at least done a bit of Googling, right? Hadoop MapReduce, or just the MapReduce concept itself, right? When it was created with some goals in mind, okay? The goals were that you have huge amount of data, which is like 50 GB of 100 GB of data, or several terabytes or petabytes of data, which you have to process, right? You have to process altogether. And the conventional systems were taking hours, and in some cases, days to process it, right? I know a big retailer in US, I don't want to take, because we tune those jobs for them in Hadoop. And their pricing job was kind of taking almost 27 hours. 27 hours is more than a day, right? So the thing is, when we used Hadoop to migrate the jobs, okay, it was taking almost 4 hours. So that was a big thing. But anyway, the point which I want to convey to all of you is there were some certain design goals for Hadoop. Okay, and the design goals for Hadoop were to do batch processing faster. Okay. Wherein you had a huge amount of data, let's say 10 terabytes, 20 terabytes, and several terabytes of data, which otherwise would have taken days, could now be processed in hours, right? That was the design goal. That was the idea about Hadoop. So Hadoop was fast. Hadoop was very fast as compared to the traditional system. So far, so good, right? But this was just a start. That is where companies started adopting Hadoop, but very soon they realized that you do not have just the batch analytics problems, right? You do not have just the batch analytics in the companies. You have interactive dashboards, right? Ever-changing reports, ad hoc reports, which are almost like real-time or near real-time kind of data. And at that place, Hadoop actually failed, because at that point of time, you needed some sort of real-time processing. You needed some sort of processing which is processing good amount of data, okay? Not as huge as batch, but still quite good amount. And it had to be processed within seconds or less, you know, sub seconds. That's where you were hitting a wall with Hadoop, because the way MapReduce executes its programs, right? The way MapReduce executes its programs, its overhead itself takes it to several seconds. So wherever responses were expected in sub-second kind of thing, fractions of seconds, Hadoop was not the answer. So far so good. Is everybody clear about it? Right? So now this is the limitation part. That's what you are seeing as red cross, real-time processing, not fast enough, right? So now the point comes, right? Now the point comes that what exactly, you know, since Hadoop is not exactly going to fill up that space, there has to be some solution. There has to be some solution like Spark. Okay, so right now, if you see conclusion, it is essential that you have to do the real-time processing. Companies do have those use cases, and you have to use something like Spark, though the slide says using Spark, right? So now I will explain this part. Okay, so first of all, that small, you know, that real-time processing, typically if you implement out after this webinar, if you get the time, you can Google out for something called Lambda architecture. Okay, Lambda architecture. Typically companies needed, you know, some sort of place wherein they have the view from the batch processing, and at the same time some amount of hot data which is being processed, which shows the recent views, you know, the recent amount of data. What might be the example of such real-time processing? What might be the example of real-time big data processing? Right? So Pradeep, Sudhakar, and I'm sure many people are probably kind of getting confused in terms of real-time processing, the meaning of real-time processing in big data domain. Does anybody have any idea? Let's say any use case, simple. Let me just give you a use case. Okay. Recently, and you guys can, you know, confirm whether it makes you or not. So real-time processing, probably people can say, you know, bank transaction. Well, bank transaction is OLTP. Okay. Bank transactions and all are OLTP. The best thing, as probably Jahar Tyagi and others actually were giving me the example, IRCTC, by the way, guys, IRCTC is not really the example of real-time processing in terms of big data. Let me give you some example very quickly. Very recently we had IPL and then the World Cup, cricket. Recently we had Wimbledon also, you know, these events and other stuff, right? So whenever you have the match starting, or, you know, usual matches starting, you must see some of the updates, right? That many number of tweets have happened for #Wimbledon, right? #Wimbledon 2015 thing. That many, this particular player is very famous by the time match starts, right? Or that particular team is the most out right now. Who is the most well player? Who do you think, you know, is gonna win the match at the start, in the mid of the match, and by the time, let's say, the second innings of the match starts? Am I right? So all of those things, and you keep on seeing those kind of you know, statistics being displayed, you know, continuously. And you must, if you were paying attention, you saw those trends kept on, right? So the kind of data which is there, you don't really need to analyze all amount of data which has come since morning. No, your trends, let's say when the match was starting, probably you were looking at the tweets which were there since last 2 hours, right? But when the match approached and match reached to the first innings, right, then you must be interested only in the tweets of last 2 hours to be analyzed and to give you the trend. Are you all getting the point? Are you all getting the, right? Now this is something, and you are still doing a bit kind of a batch processing, right? You are still doing a kind of a batch processing, but it is on a chunk of data. It's kind of a window kind of operation, right? It's kind of a windowed kind of an operation wherein, right? So this is something which is, this is where I'm just giving you one example wherein it is sort of a near real-time processing. There is even more, so this is the easily relatable kind of answer, right? There is one more. Let's go to the banking domain. Okay. Okay. So as I think probably one or two people even asking that, can you give another example? Yes, definitely. Take one more example, and then we'll move on to the other, you know, slides also. So guys, I'm not sure how many of you have used Citibank credit cards or how many of you are actually holding it, but I'll give you a simple scenario, okay? And actually, okay, I was involved in implementing that part for Citi. So let's say you are having a credit card. You do a simple transaction using credit card. You know, you bought something. The amount, your credentials were right. The amount which you are entering falls within your credit limit and all. So the transaction, whatever you did, went successfully, went through very successfully, no problems at all. Transaction approved. Now, within 1 hour, there is one more transaction from your credit card. Okay, again, credentials are perfect, everything is perfect, amount which is being entered is within the credit limit, but now, apart from the transaction data, there is, you are capturing some sort of geological, the geographical data, basically the location data, right? The location data says the second transaction which has happened is, the first is like, so the first one originated in Delhi and second one originated in Mumbai, right? Now this is something, if you just look at the financial transactions, there is no problem. But the moment you add this context, there are systems which identify that within 1 hour, you cannot reach from Mumbai by whatsoever means. Right? In this case, the transaction does go to the payment detection system. Sorry, payment gateway. It goes to the referral, wherein, I'm not sure how many of you, but you actually get the call from customer care saying that, sir, so and so, transaction is happening on your card. Is this you who is doing the transaction or not? Right? If you approve, then the transaction basically goes through. Right? Now, this is another case wherein it actually comes for real-time processing. You cannot actually tell the customer, sir, we see that this transaction has happened, but we feel that it is a fraud. Right? You cannot do that. You have to do it right when the transaction is initiated. Are you getting the point? Right now, this is something, this is, so the kind of platforms, again, the processing for it, the system which is handling payment gateway, the system which is handling the referrals and all, might be your enterprise systems, legacy systems, but the guy who is doing this routing, those kind of platforms are called CEP platforms, complex event processing platforms. Systems like Spark, systems like Storm and other stuff, they are actually tuned for it. Well, just to give you the idea, when I implemented it, at that time I implemented it in Storm. I didn't implement it in Spark. Okay, but yes, having said that, Spark has those capabilities. It was sometime back. Guys, got the idea? Right? So this is just one part of it. Now, let me just continue the. So now comes the next part, which is like the survey and its overall uses there, right? Okay. There are few questions, guys. Please forgive if I am not able to answer all of your questions because there are like so many questions. Let me just clear, complete few slides and then I'll be taking few more questions from you, right? Okay. Now, let's come and talk about the Spark survey, 2015 again. The way it stands in market, and these are few of the statistics which come for Spark, right? So let me just first tell you the respondent community. Let me not even go how many are planning, how many are evaluating and all that stuff. Let us come directly from the use case of people who are actually going to use it, right? So if you see, there is a small thing which talks about the respondents, right? So if you see, the maximum respondent community is the developers. No surprises, no prizes to get that. But guys, have you seen that 8% data scientists? This is a big, big change between Hadoop and Spark. The data scientist community typically likes to work. You, I'm not sure how many of you have actually interacted with the data science guys, or I have no idea. So who might even be there as the data scientist, right? So data scientist, the difference between a data scientist and or a data engineer is the data scientists do a lot of ad hoc work, right? They might be having some sort of hypothesis, then they have their data, and they just need a playground to verify their hypothesis, whether it is correct or not, create some model, and then, you know, eventually pass it on to the engineering team to productionize it, right? If any of you have got that experience working with the scientist teams, right? But the idea is they do not have the patience or the width to go through that entire development cycle together. They have to have something which is active. That's where Spark gets one advantage. It is fast, yes, sure, but it is interactive. You can actually interact with it. With MapReduce, it's until and unless you are using Hive or Pig, it is not really possible. And plus, it is quite also there, right? With Spark, they get this interactivity. So apart from developers, data scientists is the other community which is really, really eager for it, right? The other things, right? Kind of languages. If you see, of course, most of the code or most of the projects, even open source or the proprietary ones, you will see are there in Scala. Okay. Second language is Java. Again, when I say Java, my request would be, in case if you want to explore Spark on your own and you decide to go with Java, my request will be, please choose for Java 8. Do not choose for version lesser than that. The reason being, the Java 8 supports functional programming, right? And the programs, be it for Spark or MapReduce and other stuff, they are much easier to write in the functional programming way rather than in the object oriented fashion, right? So that is something. Then Python, of course, it's the language of the data scientists also. So this is the, of course, that makes it another popular language. Well, just 1.5 weeks back, just 1.5 weeks back, and hence you are not seeing this in the slide, Spark has announced the support for data frames in R. R is a statistical language, okay? So that is something which will come, and full support for R is there in the future. But yes, as of now, they have introduced the support for data frames and other stuff, right? So you can see that, you know, Spark is kind of a very much polyglot kind of a nature, right? Polyglot kind of a system altogether, right? So this is something wherein I would like to focus, because others are more of a statistical, or I'm not sure how much of that statistics might be relatable to you. You know, like 31% companies are evaluating, 13%, only 13% as of now are running Spark in production. And there are very few. By the way, that 13% actually involves the companies like Databricks, DataStax, you know, Apache. Then there are very few companies which actually are able to, you know, use it in production as kind of replacement of Hadoop altogether, right? So these are few of the statistics. Before I come to the advantages of Spark, this is a logical place wherein, again, I'm not promising that I'm going to answer all of your questions, but let me see if I can pick some random questions or some of the common questions, right? Okay, so is Spark something which is alternative to MapReduce or to Hadoop? It is, you can say that it extends MapReduce. That is to answer Sudhakar. Okay, that is the only thing which I can answer as of now. Okay, so it is basically to extend the concept of MapReduce if you use it along with Yarn. Okay, Sudhakar. What is the difference between Spark and Storm? Very good question, Yogesh. So Yogesh, when you talk about Spark and Storm, so Storm is a specialized system. Storm just processes the data which comes in the form of a stream, okay? Whereas Spark is a framework, almost like Hadoop. Hadoop is a framework, okay? So it is not only going to produce this or process the streaming data, it will even be able to produce the data which is coming from files, or it is which is coming from RDBMS systems, or it may even expose its functionality either just as the core APIs or in the form of, you know, some SQL query engine like Spark SQL and things like that, right? So that's a whole lot of difference, right? Ankit is saying Twitter uses Hadoop or Spark. Ankit, Twitter uses almost everything in the, you know, under the light of the sun, but they are typically the heavy users of Storm. Okay, Ankit. So that is one thing, guys. Please forgive me if the answers are not up to the depth. Please understand that I have to respect the time also. Okay, I think yeah, that is more. There is one, and I think this question is like coming from many people. Last one was from Sri Chenupati. Can I learn Spark without any Hadoop knowledge, or also do we have any prerequisites like Java in as it is in the case with Hadoop? Very nice question. So, part one, you can learn Spark without knowledge of Hadoop. For sure, you might want the knowledge of Hadoop, wherein we'll talk about integrating Spark with Hadoop, right? Again, if you're integrating Spark with Hadoop, then you need to have the knowledge of Hadoop. If you're not looking for it, then you don't need it. Did I answer the first part? Second part, now you're talking about, do we need to have any knowledge? We do recommend, or we at least as of now, we are covering our courses with Scala, and we do understand that not many people would be aware of Scala, so we cover it as part of our course itself. Okay, Chenupati, and by the way, this was a question from many people. I hope you are kind of, you know, getting the answer right, guys. Okay, now just going ahead again, these are just some which taken and answered. Sorry if you had other questions. I'll give you some handles wherein you can drop your questions and you can get the answers also, even post the webinar. Now coming back to the webinar, because we are left with under 20 minutes or so, right? Now the advantages of Spark, right? Again, this is at a, I would say, guys, this is at just 20,000 feet level. Okay, in some cases Spark is almost 100 times faster than Hadoop, for sure. I personally have seen that, if not 100, then at least like 90%, 90 times faster and all. In fact, you will see the example right now. Rather than me talking about it, let me prove it when I'll be doing it in the example in the core, you know, at the end of this webinar, right? That is one. Ease of use, well, I think it should be quite clear. The majority of your community, developer community, comes from Java or Python or even with Scala and all, right? There is already the support for these three languages, and it is even growing, you know, with R. And tomorrow there are talks to include Pig, to include Haskell and other stuff. That will happen in future. But the thing is, as of now itself, it is quite easy to use. The concept of generality, and that is where I was just coming, that Spark scores over other real-time processing systems like LinkedIn uses Samza, or you have Storm, or there are several others, right? Drill and all. Spark gains a point over its competitors because it is based on the principle of generality. It exposes the core Hadoop, core Spark APIs, which can be used as it is, or you have the abstractions on the top of it, like Spark SQL. So you are not a programmer guy. You are from the data warehousing background. You want to learn Hadoop, Spark part of it, right? You don't really need to know much of the core Spark APIs. As far as you are comfortable with SQL, you can use it with Spark SQL. If you are a machine learning enthusiast, as of now, though the library is still in the alpha release, it will mature over the period of time. But MLlib is the answer for it, right? You want to do some sort of graph processing. Again, it is in the nascent stages, but it is just evolving day by day, sort of, right? So once it comes into the beta release, you can do all of those graph algorithms and all. Again, they are all of them would be using the underlying APIs. So it's more from the generality perspective itself, right? Other thing, which is the biggest advantage of Spark over any other system, is it is easily integrable with most of the popular cluster managers. Typically, you are talking about big data processing, right? So you would be doing the big, you know, this big data processing on a cluster. Typically, you would need a cluster manager, and the most popular cluster manager is Yarn, right? It has got excellent integration with Yarn. If you don't want to use Yarn, you just want to use HDFS as your backend storage, you can do that very easily without even using Yarn. Okay, so we'll cover all of these things in the actual course at that point of time. Or there is Mesos, you can use that. Or for that matter, you are not interested in Yarn, you are not interested in Mesos, you want to use Spark's own cluster manager, it is quite possible, you can use that. From the storage perspective, you can have the data stored in HDFS or Cassandra or HBase, any of them, you know, Spark is able to pick the data from them and do the processing. So these are some of the, you know, advantages of Spark. A quick comparison between Hadoop and Spark altogether, right? Very, very quick comparison altogether. Before I move, I think there are some people who are just talking about, like, what are the competitors of Spark? Guys, you must have got the answer, isn't it? Storm is one example. Samza is another example. Drill is another example. There are some specialized systems, right? Taze and all. They are the other examples. There is Aster Data. There is Asper itself. There are so many systems, right? Only thing is, they are specialized. I hope you guys are getting the answer, right? There are other things wherein people say that what makes Spark many times faster. So guys, it is basically the in-memory processing, distributed in-memory processing. That is something which makes Spark much faster as compared to Hadoop. Got it? Again, these are, rather than the answers, these are probably, you can take it as the directions of your answers. Right, guys? If you could confirm, that would be great. Right? Okay. Just moving ahead. All right. Now, a very quick comparison altogether. Again, you can see that it's about, you know, 100 terabyte data, which, you know, sorting and all. Well, in 2013, if you're talking about the sorting using 2,100 machines, Hadoop took 72 minutes. In 2014, the same sorting in Spark. But yes, there is a fundamental difference of something called RDD, Resilient Distributed Datasets, which is like in-memory thing in their distributed fashion. Then 207 machines were used, and the time which was taken was just 23 minutes, right? This is something which is in the public knowledge. This is, we are not, you know, cooking up that data, of course. But yeah, very quick differences. Hadoop MapReduce is fast, for sure. But remember, fast as compared to what, right? It is fast as compared to the conventional systems. Spark is faster than that, right? And there is a spelling mistake here, or there's a typo. It should not be saying Hadoop Spark. It should be saying Apache Spark. Okay, so Spark is almost 100 times faster. Again, guys, please understand, not always. 100 times faster if your data operation, which you are doing, is favoring it, right? But still, several times faster than MapReduce, for sure. Hadoop is typically for batch processing. I would say Spark is the widest use case of Spark in industry is fast batch processing or near real-time processing, okay? Hadoop MapReduce, it stores the data on disk, it stores Spark. Though the line says stores the data in memory, I would like to tell you, you can store the data in memory, you can store the data in the disk, or you can store the data in the combination of that. Okay, so you can just use any of them. Okay, it is, both are open source. Hadoop is written in Scala. Okay, so very quick this thing. The modules in demand, well, nothing beats the core APIs. because you are the developers. You might be a Java developer, a Scala developer, a Python developer. You would like to work with the core APIs. That is highest in demand. Then the second thing, which is streaming TV, yes, it is, because it's a direct competitor of Storm. But then the thing which surprises me also is machine learning library is more famous than Spark SQL. Probably it is because the slide is a bit old, I would say. The Spark SQL is the next used library altogether. It gives you so much advantage. You know what? Your Hive code, which you write, you can use it as it is without even a single line of code change in Spark SQL. Without even a single line of code change. That's a big thing for the existing systems which are in production. That means a lot. By the way, this is something which was announced very recently, and I'm quite happy to say that in Edureka we always cover it. Right? So that is something which and that makes Spark SQL very much important. And then machine learning library MLlib is kind of it is still in the alpha releases, right? So machine learning library, graphics and all, they are still to get that kind of maturity. But yes, over the period of time, they will definitely be quite popular. So this year, specifically 1.5 weeks back, almost 1.5 weeks back, there are some major changes which have happened in the area of Spark. I was telling you, right, that Spark has introduced the support for data frames. Guys, this is a much, much bigger change. Okay. I don't have the freedom of that much time, but right now, just I am telling you, with the introduction of data frames, they have integrated functionality of R, they have integrated the functionality of files processing, they have integrated the functionality of Hive, everything in a single unit interface altogether. This was never ever there in Spark. There is a major release called 1.4, which is 1.5 weeks back. As of today, we cover release 1.4 in our curriculum. So just to give you an idea, machine learning pipelines are being developed. As of now, we don't cover MLlib because it is not yet stable. But yes, it is. We give enough idea about it, right? External data sources, well, external data sources and all, this is just something which is extended, but the biggest is basically the data frame support. Okay, so that is something which is we are left with the last 10 minutes, guys. I hope it should be okay if I just continue for another five or 10 minutes extra than 10 p.m. Is that fine with everybody? Basically, my idea is not to rush, to go and try to deliver something which is kind of meaningful. Make sense, right, guys? Sure. Thanks for the support. Okay. Very quickly about the Spark career, again, quickly, because you guys yourselves, right, must be aware of some of these parts. But for the starters, right, it should not come as a surprise to you. If you look at the left hand side, you know, so 74% kind of job roles which industry has, or I would say even my company also has the very same thing, it's typically from the developer community, right? 7.5% or something, that is from the data science community. Again, those guys who are paying attention, you must be able to correlate it with the community which is responding to it, right? And that's the kind of job roles, which are going to be used. Then, software architects, well, there are very few software architects who can say that I'm a Spark system, architect, because I would say if there are some people like this, then they can be only and only in the companies like Databricks or Apache, not many companies, right? DevOps, business analyst, and others. So this is something which is more from the job profile part of it. I would not go much into this until unless somebody has a question about this job role part, right? Job trends, again, don't believe me. You can open Naukri.com, Indeed.com, and try to find, right? What are the job trends which are there, right? That is one. And then companies which are using it, guys, the fact that you are attending that, and if your company name is not there, you can easily understand that yes, you are also the ones, or your companies are also the ones which are going to use it, right? There is a significant difference between your company and the companies which are mentioned here. They are not just the users, they are the contributors also. So they contribute back to Spark community. Okay, so this is that's the reason due to which we have specifically mentioned that all of these are like contributing to the open source part. Another thing which talks about like industry adoption, again it should not come as a surprise that majority is still evaluating it. There are still big potential where people actually are just talking about exactly, right? So there are, you can see that it is still at the place where Hadoop was some 3 years back. Companies just started realizing its potential. So that is something which is the next wave anyway. How companies are using Spark? It should not come as a surprise. I was just telling you, even in my company, even the other clients for which I work, most of them have realized that yes, they have achieved some sort of fast processing in their batch. But if they can forego some sort of amount, the amount of data they have to process, and if they can get some sort of, their batch processing a bit faster, companies are ready to spend the time and money on it. So that's the biggest thing. Event stream processing, I was just giving you some example, Twitter streams, examples, fast data queries. Oh, that's a big use case altogether. There are a lot of hype projects. By now, there are a lot of hype projects which are there. And if I come and tell you that you can just migrate your code base without doing any code change into just to run the very same query, let's say 10 times faster, everybody is more than happy to do it. Am I right? So those are a few things. Improved programmer community productivity, I would say it is more of a selling point. It depends how good a programmer you are, right? Just that, you are going to code more in the functional way. That way you have to write much lesser code as compared to MapReduce, for sure, right? So this is something, you will see one example of it as well. So these are some of the primary areas of focus. Now, before I move to hands-on, there were few questions wherein people wanted some answers, right? Okay, seems like there is one person who says, please answer my question, which programming language is good to learn Spark, Scala or Python? Okay, Sandeep, the answer is pretty simple. Hadoop is written in Java, so we recommend Hadoop. Spark is written in Scala, we recommend Scala. Did you get the answer now? That is point one. Second, you can use Java, but you can use Javaite. Got it? You can use Python also, but there are certain functionalities which are not supported in Python, like working with sequence files and all. Got it? I hope you got the detailed answer. Right, Sandeep, if you are still listening to us. Right? How will it help from the sales background? Very tricky question, Sharad. I would say it depends, right? If you are in a, basically deals with Spark projects and all, this knowledge might help you that way, right? How much would it help someone is aware of Scala and Hadoop? Well, you're more than half of the way is already won, right, Kunal? Because Hadoop, not as much, but at least Scala, right? And more than Scala, the functional programming, what exactly is functional programming, how you can blend it with the object-oriented programming, right? Again, guys, I hope you want, if I now move to the hands-on part, you can probably appreciate the fact that there are around 100 people. Those are the only few samples which I could answer, which are like most frequently asked question, right? right? Now, coming to the hands-on part. So as I promised, let me just go to my virtual machine. Okay, before I go to hands-on part, I'm sure many of you would be in a hurry to log out. So after I come, you know, complete the hands-on, do you remember the question with which we started the topic of this webinar? Is Spark going to replace Hadoop? Is Spark going to replace Hadoop or not? Right? So the answer is Spark will replace MapReduce and it will run on the top of Hadoop. So the answer is you will replace MapReduce. You will not replace Hadoop. Okay? You will coexist with Hadoop. Okay? Now, those people who understand the concepts of yarn might have got the answer. Those people who do not understand it, I would say, guys, as of now, understand that Hadoop has opened itself. Earlier, Hadoop was very tightly coupled with MapReduce. Now, with Yarn, Yarn has opened itself to MapReduce, to some other frameworks which can talk with Yarn. And the good thing is, Spark can talk with Yarn. So now, whatever applications were possible with MapReduce, you can write them very much in Spark programs altogether. So that is something which is kind of, you know, which should just give you some idea about it. What is IoT? Okay, I'll give you the full form, Murari. Internet of Things. Okay. Now, I'm sure you must be interested in more than that, right? So, would you be able to Google that? Right? That is just one thing. Just try that, you'll get a lot of idea about it. There is one person who, Ganeshwar, sorry, you must have asked this question many times, wherein he says, what industries are using Scala, Java or Python? I hope your question is from the perspective of Spark. And then the answer is, the preference is Scala. What am I trying to achieve? Everybody of you, I'm sure most of you have heard about word count. Everybody, it's a hello world, right? I'm not going to teach you what is word count. Nothing. At least you have heard about it. What I'm going to do is, I will take this one input. Okay, one input. I will run MapReduce word count example. Okay, we'll produce the output. We'll see the output. We will see how much time does it take. Okay, then I will run the Spark code, the same word count, and then we'll see what time it takes on the same input, on the same machine. So we are comparing apples to apples. Looks like a plan. Does everybody now understand my intention? Because see, I should not just be running some commands. You should also be understanding what am I trying to achieve. Is that clear to everybody? Fair deal, right? Okay, let me just get started. So, let me first show you few things. Okay. Clear it up and go back. Clear it up. So, this is where my data is. Hello Spark input. Okay, so let me just say head. You can see that there are some records, Vishal, Vishal, Vijay, B, etc., etc. Basically, it's a copy paste, right? How many records are there? It should be some significant amount, right? 393,000, almost like 4 lakh records or 400,000 records, right? Just as 400,000 words, right? So let us do one thing. Let us run our word count program. For that, I will take the advantage of my inbuilt programs and I will just go there. Da, da, da. This is my yarn command, which I'm firing. Those guys who are not aware of YARN, please do not bother, because this is something which is for the demonstration purpose, for the comparison, right? So I've just fired this, wherein you can see this is my input and I'm expecting my output at YARN output, right? Those people, you can see this, my job is running. Click, it shows running. Control R, succeeded. And the time which is taken, I hope everybody is able to hear, right, is 14 seconds, right? The time which is taken is 14 seconds, right? Now, this is something which we did. Let us see the output also. We have taken that pane, Hadoop FS hyphen cat yarn underscore output. Ideally, there should not be more than 3-4 records in it. So you can see the word Vijay appeared 98304 times, Vishal appeared so many times, and B, there is another word which appeared like 98 something, right? If you add it up, it should be actually 3,93,000 some records. Everybody good so far? Now, I'm going to Spark. So I'm going to fire up my Spark shell. Okay. And then you saw that my Hadoop job ran, right? I fetched the data from HDFS, right, guys? In order to run my MapReduce job, I had to fetch the data from HDFS. Let me just do the same things, apples to apples comparison. See this. Can you see this? This is the SDFS path. The same SDFS path. Hello Spark input, right? So right now, please do not bother. If you do not understand the syntax right now, okay? How many of you have seen word count program? Java MapReduce word count program. How many of you have seen that? I'm sure all of you, right? What is the number of lines? What is the number of lines? What is the number of lines? Quickly. 200? Definitely not 4. Kunal, how can you say 4? Number of lines. Hadoop MapReduce. Okay? Around 100 lines. Around 100 lines is correct. Right? Around 100 lines. Java MapReduce program. Right? Including import statements and everything. Right? Now, this is MapReduce program. This is the word count program in Scala. That is something I just made it a bit more readable. Otherwise, I could have completed it in 2 lines. So again, this should be good enough to tell you some things, right? I'm not trying to convey anything here. You guys are also programmers, right? So you can understand it very quickly. And right now I'm just doing it one by one so that everybody understands that you always tokenize, you always emit word comma one, right? And then you always do the sum for the given key, right? So right now, I'm just capturing the essence, guys, and doing nothing else. Okay. So yes, this is a Scala code which I'm doing. And let me not even store it. Let me just print it for you very quickly. Done. Let me just run it once more. Can you see this? I'm just printing it out. I could have even saved it. But can you see this? And just for the sake of it, please see the numbers also. Hold on. For your reference, please see the numbers, so that you are aware that I'm using the same thing. And please see the highlighted time 0.060771 seconds versus 14 seconds. Now you can do the math. Right, guys? How was it? How was it? I just want to know from you. Right? That's what I said. I will walk my talk. I will show it in the system whether it works or not. The same data, same thing, same machine. Nothing has changed. RAM, everything is same. Okay? Everything is same here. Nothing has changed. Right? That is all, guys, I wanted to say. I hope you enjoyed it, this webinar. If you enjoyed, you liked it, my request is, guys, do fill the feedback. That is at least, only this much is the request from you. And that is it. And hopefully, if you like it, we'll meet sometime in one of the batches, which will start sometime later. Now, after this, those guys who have not got the answers, guys, you can drop the mails to our support team. And I think there is a Twitter handle also. You'll get those specific answers about batches and this part, right? Please do fill the feedback. I would look forward for that. Thanks a lot. With that, logging out. And yes, recordings will be available in LMS.